Good day to all of you. Here we are back again on a Saturday and with a slightly unusual topic. Most topics are unusual what we take up on Saturday every life, but something that struck me because very often people talk about success, progress, and whenever they talk about achievers or something, one of the things that they say is that they have an open mindset. They have a growth mindset. They are willing to take risks. They are willing to do this and that. And that is what creates success. And that is what makes people reach the top and stuff like that. Okay, I don't deny that. To a great extent, it is true. But let us look at the other side of the picture. People who do not have a growth or open mindset, those who have a closed or a fixed mindset. How would you define such people? They are people who believe to a great extent that they are right and often avoid new perspectives or new way of looking at things. They believe that they are either good or bad at something. They make up their mind to that. And they talk about things called inherent nature. They would say things like, you know, I am a natural born painter. I can paint very well. Or the other way around, I am no good at sports. So they reach certain conclusions and they stick to those conclusions. Okay. Now you may think that that's a very bad thing to do, no? But that's not true. Surveys have shown and researchers have understood that people with a closed mindset do very well in their area of specialization because they don't want to change, they don't want to take risks, they don't want to get into new things. So what they do is they keep on focusing on what they are doing and they become better and better in whatever they are doing. They are also generally self-critical, you know, and that motivates them to do better and better. No, I have to be perfect. They are in many ways, many of them are perfectionists. So I want to ensure that I do better because they identify themselves with their domain specialization. They can't look beyond whatever they are doing. So that is how they sometimes become very good compared to people who have a growth mindset and who are exploring in 10 different ways. People with a closed mindset generally don't give up also easily. When they believe this is what is to be done and this is how it is to be done, they don't give up easily. They're very persistent people. And while they continue with this perfectionist type of attitude, they become specialists and they take up what I would refer to as programmed decisions. You know, it's like you have a computer, the computer is programmed. So you are, you have loaded MS Word or you have loaded Excel or whatever it is. So what happens is that any decision which has to be taken on calculation, the Excel will do. Anything to do with words, MS Word will do. It is programmed, right? Some people who have this closed mindset, they become like computer programs. They do exceedingly well, in whatever are called programmed decisions. You ask them to do something different, they don't. They just can't. They don't even attempt it. And if they attempt also, they fail. It is how we are taught in our basic education system that this is in the syllabus and this is not in the syllabus. So if a student asks a question pertaining to the subject that the teacher is teaching, still the teacher will say, this is not in the syllabus. I'm not going to answer you. Don't waste your time thinking about that. Focus on whatever is there in the syllabus. Complete this portion. So we are actually, many of us are actually drilled into us that we should have that closed mindset. What is in the syllabus and what is not in the syllabus. Okay. Now let us compare that with people who have this thing called the growth mindset. They are open to the thing. So they view intelligence, abilities, talents as learnable. and they believe that they are capable of change and improvement through effort. They also learn from others. If they are not competent in something, they identify somebody who is competent and they start learning, they start observing, they start learning from them. Their focus is on improving how to do what they do and also what are the new things that they can do. There's that proverb, no, that leaders don't do different things. They do things differently. And that's why quite a few of the leaders are people with that growth, mindset. They want to keep on developing new skills from time to time. And they view failure as part of their learning. People with a closed mindset, they can't take failure. They have to be. They will do anything. They will move heaven and earth to ensure that they don't fail. But only in the portion that has to be covered, only whatever is in the syllabus. Even in work life, there is a syllabus. This is my job designation. This is what I need to perform. I will make sure that I am so perfect in it that nobody will be able to point out fingers. But don't ask me to do anything else. Don't ask me to take what is referred to as non-programmed decisions. Something which is different, something which I've never handled. I either don't want to do it, or even if I do it, I don't generally succeed in the thing. Now, if you are the type of person who embraces challenge, who sets aside time to do something differently, to experiment, to take risks, that is when it is called a growth mindset. But both have some advantages and disadvantages. Some of these people, not everybody, for example, is capable of doing everything. So if a person decides that I want to grow into 10 different things, the person can actually cause harm to himself and his work. He will not be focusing on one thing, he'll start looking at different things. I've seen, for example, successful entrepreneurs. They have a startup, they get going, and things are moving very well. But they're not satisfied with the progress. What they do is, they start diversifying very early. They start looking at 10 different things. Now, that is meant to be a growth mindset, but what happens to their basic work? It is not, progressing the way it should have progressed, because their mind is on 10 different things. Similarly, it can also happen to people with, a closed mindset. One of the classic examples, history has forgotten him and, nobody even talks about him anymore. There was this fantastic person called Osborne. He was in the US and, moving into the world of technology at the same time as Bill Gates. And many people say that he was far more intelligent or capable compared to Bill Gates. Osborne designed the first portable computer in the world. Until then, computers were only those desktops, no, which were heavy and that we put on the table. And then there was a CPU and there was a monitor, there was a keyboard, all with wires attached and all that. For the first time, he devised a computer which is portable. You can pick it up and carry. It was heavy, not like our laptops, but still it was a great innovation. So you can take it anywhere. It had a battery backup, or you could plug it in wherever you go, you could carry it with you. For that time, and I'm talking about 50 years back, it was an amazing invention. It was named after him. That computer was called Osborne 1. And it started selling. Because he found it so successful, you know what he did? He set up a chain of factories to manufacture that computer. He appointed hundreds of salesmen and various other people. He had this big team working with him. He took huge bank loans because he knew that my computer is already a success and I could keep selling. But he made one fundamental mistake. He was such a, curious person and such a progressive person. He himself was not satisfied with his computer. So he started tinkering around and he started developing a better computer than that. He said, I can do it. Given some time, I can make a computer which is far better than what is there now. And he made one fundamental mistake. He announced to the world that very soon I'm coming out with Osborne 2, which is going to be cheaper, lighter, better, faster. What happened to the sale of Osborne 1? It stopped. People said, if Osborne 2 is coming, which is so much better, why do I buy? I'll just hang around for some more time and wait. And to his bad luck, he couldn't perfect Osborne 2 on time. In the meanwhile, he had this huge salaries to pay. He had establishments, he had overhead expenses, he had bank loans, and everything collapsed like a pack of cards. And that was the end of his career. These are real life incidents which we need to think from time to time as to what, you know, you can do. For example, if you have a growth mindset, etc., are you also aware of certain limitations which you cannot do? That again is questionable. You say, who decides what I can do and what I cannot do? There's this wonderful young lady, I've forgotten her name, who came from a very small town in Andhra Pradesh. And she had this great desire to become an astronaut. Imagine sitting in some remote area somewhere. She had this dream of being an astronaut. She went and enrolled herself in aeronautical engineering. And she started looking at ways and means to become an astronaut. By the time, her vision had become a little low and she started wearing thick spectacles. And everybody told her, forget about astronaut, you can't even apply to become a pilot with your vision. That's the end of it, forget it. She said, okay, can't help it. But she continued with her studies of aeronautical engineering. She finished that. She went to the US. There she specialized in something. I don't know the exact intricacies and details. But she became a specialist in a certain area which is needed on board the spaceship. And she has already flown in space. She is an astronaut. She's not a pilot in the sense she doesn't, you know, control the aircraft or the spaceship. But she does a lot of technical stuff on that, which is as crucial. And she is an astronaut. You have to give her that label that she's an astronaut. This is, as I said, you know, both sides of the coin. What is it that you can do and what is it that you cannot do? And who decides which? But one thing is very clear, which I always, you know, point out. Forget about careers and achievements and progress and all that. Do you have an open mindset to think about yourself, your loved ones, your family? I think that is very important. There are people who put down their children. They don't allow them to, you know, grow and prosper the way they should. There are spouses who put down their own spouse and they say, no, you're not capable. You should not do this. I will tell you what has to be done and be better. This is our family tradition. We have to do it only in this manner. How many children I see who suffer because they are progressive. They've got that growth mindset, as we say. And they want to do things in life. But the parent is having a closed mindset. The parent feels no. No risk taking. It's a matter of your whole career. You can't do this. You can't do that. You have to stick to whatever is being done. Don't be foolish. Don't try these new things, all these things. And this is so common. Just recently, we were sitting in the office and we were discussing this. We had a few counselees who were going through these sort of situations. So we were just thinking, you know, how sometimes a spouse puts on a partner because of the closed mindset. Sometimes how a parent puts down a child because of that closed mindset. So I asked our people, you know, why don't you enact a quick sort of role play, as you may call it, to highlight how it happens, where it happens. And you watch it and ask yourself, haven't you seen this?
see, tomorrow we have a function in our office. You must wear sari.
I have a new dress. Can I wear that new dress and come?
No. It's my staff function. You have to wear sari. And I'm telling you should listen.
Please, I look very nice. It's a new dress, so I can wear that, no?
No. Women look good in sari. And it's high position there. So what do you think? You should wear sari.
I really don't know how to tell them. Why did I marry him? I don't know. He doesn't understand me only.
Ma.
Tell me.
I want to talk to you.
Sure.
I would like to work, Ma.
What? Work? Work for what?
My friends all are working. I also would like to go and work.
So, because your friends are going, even you want to go?
Not like that, Ma. I want to be financially independent.
Oh, you have learnt a lot. Financially independent. What is there which you are not getting at home now? Your father is earning, your brother is earning. You are getting what you want, what you need. So, where is that financial independency?
Ma, I want to use my creativity.
Use your creativity in the kitchen there along with me. Come, learn how to cook. Because when you go to work, you have to eat, right? So you need to learn to cook there. Come and learn, show your creativity in the kitchen.
Ma, please understand, Ma. I would like to work.
I really don't know. It was my mistake. Why did I allow you to study so much? I don't know. Whatever you had to do, finish it by PUC and stopped you there itself. It was my mistake. I really don't know how to handle these type of children. Nowadays, children are really out of the control there.
I don't know how to make her understand. I would like to work and be independent.
Simple thing, no? Don't we see this happening in so many families, in so many different ways? Do we even realize that this is because of what we call as a closed mindset? Tradition. This is what happens in our family. This is what happens here. This is what my parents told me to do. This is how we should do things. What will others say if we try to be different or we try to do some things in a new manner? How will society react if we do these things? So much, even in the 21st century, even with so much progress, we are still caught up with that closed mindset. And like I said, when it comes to individual, personal, family matters, it can really create problems. At the workplace, at least you can accept or you can tolerate. But you saw just now, you know, a husband is insisting that no, for the office party, the wife should wear only a sari and nothing else. Tomorrow she goes to that party and she finds some other ladies who are not wearing saris, and then she starts off arguing with her husband, and that starts off a new argument or something like that. Same thing with the child. Here is a child who is saying that I want to work, I want to be financially independent. What a wonderful thing that this child wants to be, you know, responsible and trustworthy and to do things on her own. But it's only because of our closed mindset, and we don't even realize what we are doing. In fact, I just wanted to share with you, of late, there has been a lot of research done on the brain. The brain is the last frontier of medical science. We have understood so much about various other organs of the body, but the brain is the last one, and they still say that we haven't understood everything. We've got a long way to go. But recently, after the advent of CT scans, MRIs and all that, we have been able to make progress as far as brain understanding is concerned. One of the things that has come up is that the brain has plasticity. The brain is not an inert organ which just remains as it is for the rest of your life. Earlier, we used to believe a thing like IQ, for example, buddhi, cognitive intelligence, is absolutely fixed. You cannot improve on it. You can study, you can get degrees, you can do this and all that, but your intelligence cannot increase. Recent research has shown that that is not true. The brain keeps constantly rewiring itself. the brain is capable of improving certain things. The brain is capable of learning different things or new methods which were not there earlier. Now I think we should take advantage of that. So we should not be stuck in the past saying that this is what is happening, this is how the thing is, and this is the only way to do things. It doesn't work that way. In fact, I have a request. Before we point fingers at others, those of you who have seen this little video today, can you take some time off whenever it is convenient, make a note of it and say that sometime when I'm free today, tomorrow, next week, I will sit down and make a list of the areas in which I have a closed mindset. Before I point fingers at anybody else, which is what we normally do, no? The wife will say, the husband has a closed mindset. The daughter says, mother has a closed mindset. But do they introspect what they are doing where it comes to having a closed mindset? So charity begins at home, as they say. Unless and until I understand me, my needs and how I need to do, I can't really go into the others. So this is a request that I have of you. Just keep it in mind. Sometime when you're free and relaxed, ask yourself, which are the areas in which I have a closed mindset? I tend to think that so and so people are bad, or such and such activity cannot be done. It is foolish to even attempt it. Things like that. And if you set certain goals, saying that I know this goal is difficult, but if I have this determination and if I keep setting these goals, I may be able to succeed. And success also, remember, is not a 0% and 100% thing. From zero, if you go to 10, 20, 30%, I call it success. As long as there is incremental success, growth, change, I think that is how I define success. I don't define success by the, you know, end goal. But yes, if you do set certain goals of doing things differently or doing things which you have not done before, be realistic, of course. Check out whether it is possible or not, even by an extreme situation. And if you find that, yes, it is possible, make an attempt. If you don't succeed, what is the worst that will happen? You would have learned some lessons, no? You would have learned that, yes, I tried this, I did it. Maybe I have to do something else. There was an amazing story about a young girl who was a fantastic swimmer, but she was polio afflicted. Her legs had no strength. She couldn't even walk. She had to walk with crutches or whatever. But she had started swimming and she was doing very well in swimming. So one day she set this goal saying that no disabled person has ever swam across the English Channel. That is from France to England. So I can be the first one if I put in this attempt. And she started practicing. Hours and hours of swimming, endurance, this, that, whatever has to be done, she made all the preparations. And one fine day, she announced, I'm going to swim now. And from the French coast, she jumped into the water and started swimming towards England. There was a boat following her to observe and to take care of her and all that. And she was swimming. She kept swimming, 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 till she started getting tired. At some point, she became extremely tired. She looked in front and she could only see a fog. Generally, the sea coast of UK has a fog. Nothing is visible. So when she looked forward, she could only see a fog. And she was getting extremely tired. At one point, she gestured to the boat, come and pick me up. I can't do it. My strength is giving way. Okay, they came and pulled her into the boat. And then they said, since we are much closer to England's coast, why go back to France? We'll drop you in England and then you can go back from there. And when the boat went towards England, she realized how close she was. And she had given up. After having covered maximum distance and having come very close to the coast of UK. So you know what she did? She made up her mind. I will attempt once more, but I will do it on a day when there is no fog on the British coast. Visibility is very clear. She waited. One bright day dawned. There was absolutely no fog. Visibility was very good. And she jumped into the water. She started swimming. She covered one third, half, two third. And she started getting extremely tired because she was swimming only with her hands. Her legs were of no use. We normally use both hands and legs to propagate ourselves, but she couldn't do that. She was getting extremely tired. At one point, she put her head up and looked straight ahead. And she could see a thin line in front. And she said, "Oh my, that is the British coast. It is visible to me. I can do it." And she would put her head down and swim, 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 swim. And when she's extremely tired, she would put her head up. And she said, now I can see the hills also. I've come so much closer. Next attempt, she would look up. I can see the trees. I've come so close. And that motivated her and she reached the British coast. She became the first handicapped girl to cross the British, the English Channel. This is something which we need to think so many times. What is it that we can do and what is it that we cannot do? Achha, if you want to overcome this closed mindset and do things, I'll give you just three or four very basic points. Number one, start observing people who have fought against all odds, who are supposedly not good at something or were not deemed to be achievers, but they did it. In any field, whichever is your field of interest. Not only observe them, but find out what they did. Biographies, I tell you, are such an amazing way to learn about life. Read up biographies, find out about them. How did they manage to overcome the hurdles? And how did they manage to, achieve something which everybody had said they are not capable of, achieving? Then reflect on where you have failed earlier and ask yourself, why did I fail? What is it that I didn't do correctly? Where do I have to bring about a new method of doing it? Thomas Edison is the best example of that. He kept on looking at different ways of how to make an electric bulb. Keep rewarding yourself for even incremental success. Even if you go 5%, 10% better than what you were before, reward yourself, celebrate. It really gives you a boost and makes you think that, yes, if I have done this, I can do something more than that. And start using the word yet. I have not yet crossed the English Channel. I have yet to achieve this. Equivalent of those words. Start doing that. And that gives you that feeling of transience. As of now, I have not achieved this. As of now, I have not gained this skill. As of now, I am yet to make progress in this area. And that gives you that feeling that all these hurdles and setbacks are transient and I can move on to doing something better. These are just few simple things. Keep it in mind. I'll take a 1 minute break and I shall be back to have a nice open dialogue with all of you.
Hi, and I'm Sonal here. I've come today to update you what's happening at Banjara and what is Team Banjara doing different things. Because if I don't say, I think hardly you people will know what's other than DCS, what Banjara is doing. Okay, I'll give you update 1, 2, 3, 4. One is our post-graduation diploma in psychotherapy, PGDP, is going to start from 25th of September. So whomever you think can be benefited from this, please tell them to contact Anise or Jennifer. They will help you out for the further details, whatever you need to know. Then, tomorrow onwards, I think Ali and Purni are going for 5 days to Dharmashala. It's somewhere up north, and they are going to do workshop for the Tibetan school counselors. Isn't it a unique program from Banjara Academy? And to tell you that Banjara Academy has been associated with Tibetan people past 30, 40 years before now. So that's the association of Banjara Academy with Tibet. Other than that, quite a few schools, as Ali was talking, I was thinking, what is the growth mindset I see these days, the trend? Quite a few schools are coming up and, you know, wants a special training for the children when it comes to understanding learning difficulty. I feel that's a quite growth mindset kind of action taken by schools, where they want to equip their own teachers to be empathetic to these children as well as families who are associated. And one more thing, even colleges where psychology is taught, they are approaching if we can give them, you know, short courses on counseling to their students. So I think these are the different things that Banjara is doing from what they were doing earlier. So this is our growth mindset that's happening. And now over back to Ali.
Yes, that is something that we always enjoy. We keep prodding each other and we keep telling, come on, you can do this, I can do this, we can do this. And we always have this thing. In fact, just to share with you, tomorrow, our team, including me, we are going to Dharamshala. We are going for something totally new. Of course, my association with the Tibetans and their settlements and their educational institutions has been there for almost 30 years. But the first time that we are actually going to Dharamshala, where we are going to be, you know, training the counselors from of all their schools in India and Nepal. It's going to be a unique, you know, experience. The place itself, you know, Dharamshala, we have heard so much about it. So something new, something different. It's a challenge, but we always take up challenges, whether we can do it or not. One of the classic examples of this thing, if you remember, the good old film Sholay. In that, you know, the police inspector has caught these two fellows, Amitabh Bachchan and Dharmender. And, you know, Dharmender is trying to show off to the police inspector and says, okay, we are such great people, ke hum 20-20 par bhari ho jayenge. That means we can handle 20 opponents. And then he turns to his partner and he says, ke main zyada bol gaya kya? Did I say step beyond my limit? Amitabh's response was amazing. Ab boli diya hai, to kar lenge. That means now that we have committed, yes, we will do it. This is the spirit that I want all of us to have, okay? Now I have some interesting points which have already come into the chat box. We'll start with Surekha, whose thoughts I always admire. Surekha says, close-minded people suffer from possibility blindness. That's a wonderful label that you have given, Surekha. I think it's very useful. We must understand and use it also. Possibility blindness. They only manage to scrape the surface of their potential. They are blind to their own possibilities. They don't realize what can be done. If you can remove that blindness, and blindness is not just visually impaired people. We can have two perfectly good eyes and yet we can be blind in our mind. Vinita says, actually, Ali, sometimes some of them also face very bad consequences due to closed mindsets. Though we tell them repeatedly, you still don't see any change and they do it again and again. just don't know how to change their mindset. It's so ingrained, I guess. They don't see the potential or whatever it is yet. Vinita, I don't want you to give up. Keep trying. Someday you may succeed, you don't know. And to what extent also, we don't know. But if we have a mindset, we need to think that I will not give up. Just because that person is saying, no, this can't be done and that can't be done, I am not going to give up so easily, right? Okay. Now we have Surekha again. Can a closed mindset lead to loneliness because we are intolerant of people and different perspectives? Yes, Surekha. If I have a closed mindset with regard to people, I told you right in the beginning, no? People who say, this type of people are bad, those type of people you should not make friends with, these are people are not trustworthy. So if our closed mindset extends to people, then definitely you become lonely. You are creating those walls and barriers around you. You have to be very careful on that one front. How can we help a loved one grow and help her get freedom from the imprisonment of her own beliefs and biases? Of course, as I always say, no, it differs person to person, depending on your relationship and all these things. But if that person really has a closed mindset and direct advice or direct guidance may not help, one of the ways that I have been practicing and I feel that it does help is to go with the flow. If that person says, no, it has to be done only this way, I don't want to do anything different, I don't want to take chances, fine, you do it. Gently, you keep talking to that person and ask, are you happy with the way your life is going? Are you happy with your profession or are you happy with your relationships? You know. Inevitably, that person will say, no, I'm not very happy. There are certain things I'm happy about, certain things I'm not happy about. Then you pinpoint. Which is the area where, you know, which is pulling you down or which is not allowing you to be happy? It is this, right? Now, I'm not asking you to change or, you know, to give up your own beliefs. All I'm asking you is to change the method or the path by which you need to reach where you want to reach. You have been trying it in one possible way. You are stuck in a traffic jam. Traffic refuses to move. Do you have the courage to reverse out from there? Take a detour, go round and reach. That's all I'm asking you. Try that out and see if it succeeds. Shobha says, some people have their own opinions. They shouldn't agree with genuine reasons how to cope with these people. Correct. As I was just telling you, no? First acknowledge them. You have your opinions. You strongly believe in it. Okay. With those beliefs and that type of opinions, how much have you succeeded? Where have you reached? What is it that you are, you know, achieving by this? You teach me, put it to them. You please teach me and tell me. Maybe I can follow the method that you are doing. If you are open and gentle and understanding, inevitably that person will come out with, no, in this I'm not succeeding. No, I'm not very happy with this. That is when you start slowly bringing in this thing of saying that, can we look at other options? You keep doing the same thing, but try out something different or something new, which I am suggesting. No, I've tried that out. It doesn't work. I don't want to take that risk. Okay, you've tried it, but you were alone. Now I am with you. I'll do handholding. We will both work towards that. Give that little boost to the person and try and see. Meena says, close-mindedness can lead to mediocrity and stagnation. Yes, Meena, in general, I agree. But as in the beginning, I told, certain areas, let us not totally reject close-mindedness and say these people are always stagnating and this and that. No. Sometimes people with a closed mind do succeed in certain things where they have to go clear on that path. So they start becoming perfectionists in their own way. As long as they are not looking for growth or diversity or whatever it is, if they want to be happy, let us accept it. Why do we enforce our view on that? Why do we have a closed mind to closed-mindedness, isn't it? Somebody says, this is what I want to do and I'm happy with it. This is what I'm going to be doing. Respect it. But as I said, keep your eyes and ears open to see if that person at any time expresses dissatisfaction. That is when you bring back the topic again. Surekha says, being open-minded means that just because you can be offended does not mean that you must be offended. Yes, Surekha, absolutely right. This is also in another form. They say, no, that pain is inevitable. Suffering is optional. Pain will be there. Physical pain, mental pain, emotional pain. But whether you want to suffer because of that pain or you want to overlook that pain and focus on something else, that choice you have. Shobha says, it's really a great thing to see Ali and Purnima and Dharamshala. So nice of you. Yes, once we go there, then we'll tell you how things are. Let's see how it goes. It's a new experience. I have had some very nice experiences with, particularly with the Air Force. You know, I've gone to very remote and different places and I've enjoyed it. In fact, I was just recalling that when I went to a place called, Misamari, which is the last infantry divisional headquarters near China, they had taken me up in a microlight aircraft and shown me the Chinese border and that famous monastery, that Doklam, whatever they call it, which China is claiming to be theirs. I had seen that monastery. These are some memories, you know, which really help you. But you have to be open to changes. You have to be open to exploration and all that. So I'm always open. If they say, come, you want to go to Misamari? Yes, I'll go. You want to fly in that tiny little aircraft, which looks like an auto rickshaw has taken off from the ground and is flying in the air. Initially, it's very scary. But if you can learn to enjoy that, nothing like it, no? Meena says, it's prisoners of their own thoughts, limited thoughts. Yes, you used a very nice word, prisoners. That is something I think we should all be conscious of. Let us not become prisoners of our own thoughts. Let our mind and brain not become a prison which encloses and doesn't allow anything else to come in. Always be open to at least considering something different, something new, something exciting, something which looks very difficult or almost impossible. No harm in trying it out, exploring. Maybe I can also say, I told you, use the word yet. Yet, up till now, I haven't done this. But maybe tomorrow I'll be able to do it. I keep it in mind. I always tell people, keep your dreams alive. Right from your childhood, whatever dreams you had, we all tend to negate them. Now I'm too old for this. Now I'm too old for that. But if you do, keep your mind open. There's a lot that you can do. Roshan says, have faced unimaginable challenges without getting tense. Congratulations, Roshan. Open mindset has helped me to achieve any difficult situation with ease. Yes, it does. Here's a classic real life example for all of us. Always open to learning new things and meeting new people and visiting new places. In fact, Roshan reminded me of another very, very dear Parsi friend of mine who was 94 years old and he was always open to experimenting anything. New type of food, new place to travel, new anything you tell him, he was open to it. And at 94 years of age, he was fit and fine, enthusiastic and positive till the last day of his life. What a glorious life he led. Vinita says, I also feel close-minded people stop learning. Yes, that is a fact. Or they do learn, but they learn only within their area of focus. So all their efforts go to improving themselves to become perfectionist in what they are already doing. So like you saw in that short video clips, and I've had so many people appreciating them. Anis, you must tell Venu and Jennifer also that you people have got such this thing. Maybe next time you can go to Sandalwood or Bollywood and try your luck there. But like I was saying, that do I, you know, restrict myself, starting with things like the family and all that, and then moving on to other areas. They are more to listen, to win, than to understand. Yes, that's a very nice point that you brought out, Meena. If a person says, I want to learn a particular sport, why? To win the championship. Somewhere I think that person also has a closed mindset. If the person says, I want to learn this sport because it keeps me physically healthy, it teaches me so many different things, my limbs get more agile, I learn team spirit, I am out there in the fresh air, I get to meet new people. And then once I master it, if I look up and say, hey, why not? Let me enter into championships. That is how the spirit should be. That is how we should go sequentially. Even when you are talking about a growth mindset, we should, you know, enjoy the journey rather than only looking at the final destination. So my journey right now says, I'm going to learn this sport. Then I say, I'm going to be good at this. Then I say, I'm going to be competing in some tournaments. That's how the whole thing should go. Shobha says, thank you, Ali. Your words are eye-opener. Welcome, Shobha. Most welcome. Venkatesh says, hi, Ali. How is close-minded different from being narrow-minded? They're very close to each other, actually. Venkatesh, only thing is, narrow-minded people have this thing, by this word is used more from the moralistic point of view. So a narrow-minded person, like we were doing that little skit about mother and daughter. A narrow-minded mother, for example, if the daughter comes and says, I want to wear a Western dress or something. A narrow-minded mother would immediately say, you know, that is indecent. Only bad girls wear those type of dresses. Why do you want to wear those dresses? Now, you see, there's a moral angle to it. So that is what we normally refer to as narrow-minded people who try to moralize on others, who say that, no, only this is right, this is pap and this is punya, this is good and that is bad. That's how it goes. Surekha says, are close-minded people insecure? Not necessarily. Some of them are very confident with what they do. That is why a close-minded person does not argue to learn. He argues to win. Yes, when you find that a person is arguing to win and not arguing to learn, it is in certain ways an indicator that the person is feeling insecure, that I have to prove myself right. But not all people do that. You'll be amazed. There are people with closed mindset who discard everybody else. You want to try out new things, you want to do this, you go ahead and do it. I know what is good for me and I'm going to do this. They don't get into argument, they don't want to prove themselves, they don't want to listen to others. There are people like that. That's the variety of life, you know. Surekha says, do attachment and a closed mind set go hand in hand? Sometimes it does, but not necessarily. It does happen that if I am attached to somebody, you saw the mother and daughter skit now. If the mother is very attached to the daughter, if the mother wants to possess the daughter, so what did she say? Why do you need to earn? Your daddy is earning enough, no? You do your studies and you sit at home and you help me in the kitchen. Possibly why a mother would do that is that there is a strong sense of attachment, possessiveness, whatever you want to call it. So if the mother feels insecure that my daughter will go out and she will become independent, she will no longer rely on me, she will earn her own money and buy whatever she wants, she will not be leaning on me for anything, that attachment can definitely lead you to insecurities and to a closed mindset. This is a good one. Surekha says, open-minded people say, I refuse to live an unlived life. Very well said, Surekha. I refuse to live an unlived life. In fact, there's another angle, proverb also, no, similar one, which says that be not so busy making a living that you forget how to live. So many people, I feel so sad. They're caught up in that rat race. They think there's nothing beyond that. They feel they have to work harder and harder. They have to get this promotion. They have to get that. They have to succeed. They never stop and think, where am I headed? Where is this going to end up? And unfortunately, sometimes it ends up in tragedy. The fellow gets a heart attack or something else happens to him and his whole life keeps crumbling comes crumbling down after having put in so much of hard work in life. What are the advantages of being closed-minded, if any? That's what I started off with, Nomina. In the beginning, I said that there are certain advantages. That's why I would not totally condemn a person with a closed mindset. If you go back even after the session is over, you can just, in case you logged in late, you see the first few minutes I had explained what are the advantages of closed-minded people and how they have a head start over the thing, right? Reena says, some people believe they have a closed mindset because of inherited qualities from their parents. That's another very, very significant point, and I'm glad you brought it out, Reena. There are a lot of people who believe, for example, that this is inherited. This is genetic. This is imbibed and it cannot be changed. This is my karma. I don't know to what extent we can think that way, but one thing I can tell you is that if you have that determination, there's another counter argument to that also, no? That if you believe in something and you put your mind to do it, the universe conspires to help you. So these are two sides of the coin. I don't take either side. I don't believe on this extreme or that extreme. But what I do know is incremental changes. Small, small benefits, small, small thing. Enjoy on a day-to-day basis. Today I tried out something new. Today I went to a new restaurant, or I went to the same restaurant and ordered a new dish. Today I tried out a color or a dress which is different. Today I learned a new skill. As long as you are open to that and trying out things, even when you fail, you will realize that you can do very well in that. So these are some of the things, you know, which keep coming up every now and then. As I keep reminding you, these sessions are only to help you to sit up and think. These are not some discourses or gyan or some Guruji's lecture which, you know, is going to enlighten you and things of that nature. I have never sat under the Bodhi tree, so I cannot enlighten you because I'm not enlightened myself. But if I can put these little seeds in your mind, and if you allow those seeds to germinate and grow, you will find changes in your life. And my request, as always, is that when you find something works, if today's session, for example, there's something that you learned about having a closed mind, open mind and all that, please share it with others. Please tell others that this is what I think, not necessarily what I'm telling you, but whatever conclusion you have come to. You tell that this is what I think, this is what I heard, I modified it, I felt this is the best way, and I find that it is helping me. Would you like to try it out? That way we can all spread the message and try to create a better world around us, a better environment around us, which also helps us in our relationships and makes us feel happy, right? That's all the whole thing is about. Shobha says, I'm addicted to your words, Ali, like Guruji. No, please don't do that, Shobha. I would definitely not like to be a Guruji or anything like that. But yes, if the words help, you can use the words as Guru, you know. Like how, you know, the Sikh community thinks of the book as a Guru. Gurbani is what they read out. It is not the Guru, but it is the Guru Granth Sahib, they say, you know. The book, the holy book of the Sikhs, they believe in that. It has been told by so many gurus, from Guru Nanak right down to the 8th and 9th Guru, whatever it is. That's how it should be, and that's how life is all about. So with that, let me wind up. And I have Madhavi's comment. Hello, Ali, happy journey to all of you. Next, any plan to visit Dharamshala? Please, I want to join your team and I have a lot of learning. Yes, Madhavi, we'll definitely let you know. And if not Dharamshala, maybe some other exciting place. Why not try out different and new places from time to time? And we all do love travel. Our Sonal has always been telling me that we should go back to Mahabaleshwar, which we haven't gone since years. Maybe something like that. Whatever it is, travel definitely is a great learning. Sanjay says, so we need a right balance of closed mindset and growth. Yes, with preferably a little more, you know, predominance of the growth mindset. And that is what it is all about. So travel is great learning by itself. Just traveling to places, being observant, looking at different places itself is a great learning by itself. So keep that in mind. Keep learning, keep growing, keep enjoying life. And I shall take your leave. I shall be back from Dharamshala just in time for the next Saturday's FB Live program, which is on artificial intelligence versus our own intelligence. There's so much talk about artificial intelligence these days, no? What is happening to our own intelligence? I'm not an expert on artificial intelligence, and I'm not going to give you any gyan on what it is. But definitely, I'd like you to sit up and think, with all this thing about artificial intelligence going on, where do we stand in terms of our real intelligence? So see you next week. Have a wonderful time. Bye-bye.
See, tomorrow we have a function in our office. You must wear sari.
I have a new dress. Can I wear that new dress and come?
No. It's my staff function. You have to wear sari. And I'm telling you should listen.
Please, I look very nice. It's a new dress, so I can wear that, no?
No. Women look good in sari. And it's high position there. So what do you think? You should wear sari.
I really don't know how to tell them. Why did I marry him? I don't know. He doesn't understand me only.
Ma.
Tell me.
I want to talk to you.
Sure.
I'd like to work, Ma.
What? Work? Work for what?
My friends all are working. Ma, I also would like to go and work.
So, because your friends are going, even you want to go?
Not like that, Ma. I want to be financially independent.
Oh, you have learnt a lot. Financially independent. What is there which you are not getting at home now? Your father is earning, your brother is earning. You are getting what you want, what you need. So, where is that financial independency?
Ma, I want to use my creativity.
Use your creativity in the kitchen there along with me. Come, learn how to cook. Because when you go to work, you have to eat, right? So you need to learn to cook there. Come and learn, show your creativity in the kitchen.
Ma, please understand, Ma. I would like to work.
I really don't know. It was my mistake. Why did I allow you to study so much? I don't know. Whatever you had to do, finish it by PUC and stopped you there itself. It was my mistake. I really don't know how to handle these type of children. Nowadays, children are really out of the control there.
I don't know how to make her understand. I would like to work and be independent.